Hi everybody, welcome to my YouTube channel Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts and my FB page Dr. Srinivas Concepts. This is Dr. Srinivas, neurologist from Andhra Pradesh, India. I'm also the medical author of the book Focused Neurology. Today we are going to talk about a very important topic, pupil. And I believe it is going to be useful for MBBS, MD General Medicine, DM Neurology, MCH Neurosurgery, Ophthalmology, Critical Care, and almost all the specialties. Pupillary disorders is such a big topic. So I am going to touch upon only the concepts of pupillary disorders. Pupil. So what is the function of pupil? The function of the pupil is to control the amount of light it enters. So pupil controls the amount of light which enters. Right. The normal size of the pupil is about 2 to 6 millimeters. The normal size of the pupil is about 2 to 6 millimeters. Less than 2 millimeters, we call it as small pupils or meiotic pupils. More than 6 millimeters, we call it as large size pupils or midriatic pupils. Sometimes one pupil may be small, the other pupil may be large. So if there is an asymmetry of pupillary size, we call it as anisocoria. Iso means same, a means not, choria means pupil. So anisocoria means not of the same size. The pupils are not of the same size, right? Now, pupil is basically controlled by two pathways. One, the parasympathetic pathway, which runs on the third nerve, which causes constriction of the pupil. Second is the sympathetic pathway, coming from the hypothalamus, descending in midbrain pons, medulla oblongata, spinal cord, going to the cervical ganglion, internal carotid artery plexus, back to the pupil. This is the sympathetic pathway. Sympathetic pathway dilates the pupil. Parasympathetic pathway running on the third nerve constricts the pupil. So now let's go systematically and analyze the effects of each system on the pupil. First, let's go to the parasympathetic pathway, which causes the constriction of the pupil. The constriction of the pupil is done by one, the light reflex, the stimulus being light, and second, accommodation. The stimulus for accommodation is blurring of the image. So when you bring any object close to the eye and the image appears blurred, the accommodation reflex becomes manifest, it comes into action. So the constriction of the pupil is done by light reflex to the accommodation reflex. So when the pathway gets affected, the light association pathway and accommodation reflex pathway may get separately involved. That means light reflex being absent and accommodation reflex being present. So this is known as light near dissociation. The other name for accommodation reflex is the near response, and therefore we call this as light near response. Absence of light reflex but presence of accommodation reflex. This is very fascinating, the light near dissociation. So before I dwell into the pathways for accommodation reflex and light reflex, let me finish off the accommodation reflex triad. When the accommodation reflex comes into action, it causes thickness of lens, it causes convergence of the eyes, it causes meiosis, pupillary constriction. So this is known as accommodation triad. It causes thickening of the lenses so as to focus for the near vision, it causes small pupils, it causes convergence of the eyes. This is the accommodation reflex, accommodation triad. Light near dissociation. As I said, the pathways for light and accommodation are separate. We know the pathway for light reflects very well. The accommodation reflex pathway are speculated. Since the pathways are separate, light reflex may be absent and accommodation reflex may be present. So this is known as light near dissociation. To understand it, we need to know the pathways. So first let me start off with the light reflex pathway. So when we throw light on the eye, it goes to the point of maximal acuity, the macula, comes to the optic nerve. The optic nerve, as you already know, I told in the lecture on the optic nerve, the nasal fibers which represent temporal field and temporal fibers represent nasal field, and this crossing of the nasal fibers and the temporal fibers come and go down ipsilaterally. Here again, we need to know the pupillary right reflex has got direct light reflex where you throw light on the eye, it constricts. But the other pupil also constricts, which you call it as consensual light reflex. One of the causes for this direct and indirect light reflex, the presence of indirect light reflex being crossing at the level of the optic chiasma. The pupillary fibers cross at the level of the optic chiasma itself. The other area where it crosses is from the pretectal nucleus to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. So when a person throws light, it goes on to the retina, it goes to the optic nerve. The crossing of the pupillary fibers occurs in the optic chiasma, it goes to the lateral geniculate body. But even before it goes to the lateral geniculate body of the thalamus, it comes, goes to the midbrain, it goes to the pretectal nucleus. From the pretectal nucleus, it goes to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus bilaterally. So again there is crossing over of the pupillary fibers. One, the pupillary fibers cross at the level of the optic chiasma. Second, it crosses at the level of the pretectal nucleus going to both the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. Since the crossing of pupillary fibers occurs, when you throw light on the pupil, not only the pupil on the same side constricts, which you call it as direct light reflex, but also the pupil on the opposite side also constricts, which you call it as a consensual light reflex. It is because of the mixing of fibers at the level of optic chiasma and from pretectal nucleus to both the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. A very important concept, right? From Edinger-Westphal nucleus, it goes to the ciliary ganglion, and from the ciliary ganglion, it goes to the iris. So this is the light reflex pathway. The second pathway is the accommodation reflex pathway, not very clearly known, but what is speculated is that it also comes from the optic nerve, but it goes to the lateral geniculate body, it goes to the occipital cortex, from occipital cortex perhaps it goes to the frontal cortex, and it directly goes to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. It does not go to the pretectal nucleus. It directly goes to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, and then from there to ciliary ganglion, and then to the pupil. So accommodation reflex does not go to the pretectal nucleus. It goes directly to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. Accommodation reflex is slightly ventral. Light reflex is slightly dorsal in the midbrain. These are all important concepts, because dorsal midbrain syndromes, where the dorsal part of the midbrain is affected, only the light reflex is affected, but the accommodation reflex, which is ventral, is spared. So these are the pathways of light reflex and presumed pathway for the accommodation reflex, right? Now, where all the lesions can occur where light reflex is absent but the near reflex or the accommodation reflex is present? There are three areas in these pathways where light reflex may be absent but accommodation reflex is present. The first is the optic nerve, at the level of the optic nerve. When the optic nerve is affected, the light reflex, the pathway is affected, and therefore the light reflex will be absent. So if it is severe enough, it can cause blindness also. So at the level of the optic nerve, when there is a lesion here, when it is deafferented, person will have the light reflex being absent, but the accommodation reflex is present. Here there is one of very fascinating concept. I said when the optic nerve is affected, it may result in blindness and the light reflex may be absent. But very fascinating phenomenon is that even in if the person has got severe loss of vision, accommodation reflex will be present. So one, the lesion is in the optic nerve where light reflex may be absent and accommodation reflex is present, what you call it as a deafferented pupil. The second place where the light reflex may be absent but accommodation reflex is present, as I said, is in the midbrain, especially in the dorsal part of the midbrain where the pretectal nucleus is also involved. You remember I said the accommodation reflex does not go to the pretectal nucleus, it goes to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus directly, and it is slightly anterior, whereas light reflex is posterior. So there is a lesion in the pretectal nucleus, the dorsal midbrain, again light reflex may be absent but accommodation reflex will be present. So what are the lesions which can cause this? One is the midbrain lesion, that is dorsal midbrain lesion, the perinod syndrome, and second is the ARP, Argill-Robertson pupil. Easy to remember, ARP, Argill-Robertson pupil, ARP, accommodation reflex is present. So accommodation reflex present and light reflex is absent. Another area where this can happen is in the dorsal midbrain, where the light reflex will be absent but accommodation reflex will be present. The diseases causing it are the dorsal midbrain syndrome or perinod syndrome. Second is the Argill-Robertson pupil. Argill-Robertson pupil is typically found in persons suffering from syphilis. So it's a small pupil, it is an irregular pupil. The light reflex is absent but accommodation reflex is present. ARP is for ARP. So this is the second place where light reflex is absent but accommodation reflex is present. The third, as I said, accommodation reflex now runs from the Edinger-Westphal nucleus to the ciliary ganglion and to the iris. The third, when there is a lesion in the ciliary ganglion or beyond the ciliary ganglion. So when the nerve gets affected at the level of the ciliary ganglion or beyond the ciliary ganglion, like tumors or trauma, there is aberrant regeneration of the nerve and aberrant reinnervation. So when there is aberrant reinnervation, what happens? The ciliary ganglion may partially supply the iris, but the other fibers may start going to the ciliary body. So it may go to the ciliary body instead of going only to the iris. So here the accommodation reflex will be present and light reflex will be absent. Or another possibility is that the fibers may be regenerated and going to the medial rectus and the iris. And therefore when a person uses medial rectus and tries to bring the images near convergence, the pupils may become small. So because of this aberrant regeneration of the nerve, when the ciliary ganglion is cut off, the accommodation reflex is present, the light reflex is absent. Wherein there can be aberrant regeneration, the fibers may be directed to the iris and the medial rectus. So when the person converges, the pupil may become small. And it may supply the ciliary body, so the accommodation reflex is present and light reflex is absent. So this usually occurs because of tumors or trauma. And one of the well-known diseases which cause this denervation hypersensitivity, where these nerves get affected beyond the ciliary ganglion, is known as Addis pupil. Addis pupil. So in Addis pupil, light reflex is absent and accommodation reflex is present. But in Addis pupil, the pupil is large. In Addis pupil, light reflex is absent and accommodation reflex is present, but the pupil is large, where the lesion is ciliary ganglion and beyond it. Whereas in the dorsal midbrain syndrome, where the pretectal nucleus gets affected, you get Argill-Robertson pupil. There also light reflex is absent but accommodation reflex is present, but here the pupil is small. So these are two important differences. light reflex absent, accommodation reflex present can be an Argyll-Robertson pupil, but the pupil is small. Light reflex absent and accommodation reflex present can be Holmes pupil, but the pupil is large. Second thing is that, since it is denervated, if you put a small diluted pilocarpine, that is just 0.1% also, it becomes sensitive and starts reacting. Since it's denervated, small amount of pilocarpine, just 0.1% also, it starts reacting and starts producing its effect. So there is denervation, hypersensitivity. So these are all the possibilities of light near dissociation. Very interesting. There are three places where it can occur. One in the optic nerve, where light reflex is absent and accommodation reflex is present. Second is in the midbrain, dorsal midbrain, like Perrinot syndrome or Argyll-Robertson pupil, where the pupil is small but accommodation reflex is present and light reflex is absent. Third is in the ciliary ganglion, where there is aberrant regeneration, what you call as Addis pupil, accommodation reflex present, light reflex is absent, and it is denervation hypersensitivity, where if you put pilocarpine, it will react. Sometimes Addis pupil can be associated with decreased tendon reflexes. So you call it Addis Holmes, Addis tonic pupil, usually seen in young women. So this is about the fascinating concept of light near dissociation. Light reflex absent, accommodation reflex present. Accommodation reflex otherwise known as near reflex. Therefore, light near dissociation is light reflex absent, near or accommodation reflex is present. Right. Now we'll go to the another concept, Marcus gun pupil. I said the optic nerve is responsible for perceiving the light and for the light reflex, and therefore if the optic nerve gets affected, the light reflex will not be effective, and therefore pupil will not constrict. But the beauty of this is that the Marcus gun pupil, it is otherwise known as relative afferent pupillary defect. Relative, that means only one side optic nerve is affected, the fellow eye's optic nerve is intact. It is relative. So this is relative afferent pupillary defect, where the optic nerve of one eye is affected, the fellow eye's optic nerve is intact. So what will be the manifestation? The relative afferent pupillary defect. So the pathogenesis here is that there is secondary dilatation under continuous exposure. So if you throw light continuously, the basic pathophysiology of Marcus gun pupil is that if you throw light continuously on continuous exposure, say 10 to 20 seconds, instead of constricting, there is dilatation of the pupil. So this is Marcus gun pupil. So there is secondary dilatation under continuous exposure 10 to 20 seconds due to optic nerve disease. This you can make it out by swinging flash light test. So the principle is that the direct light reflex is weaker than the consensual light reflex. Imagine I have the right optic nerve is involved, the relative afferent pupillary defect. That means the right optic nerve is affected as compared to my fellow optic nerve on the opposite fellow eye. So when I throw light on my right eye, the right pupil will constrict very slowly because optic nerve is affected, and then I take the light, come back to my left eye. Now left eye, the fellow eye optic nerve is intact, and therefore when I throw light, this pupil constricts. This is direct light reflex and this is consensual light reflex when I throw light on my left eye. So left eye constricts, left pupil constricts, right pupil also constricts because of consensual reflex. Consensual reflex, the pathway is efferent pathway, third nerve. So though the optic nerve is affected on my right side, the afferent pathway, the efferent pathway, namely the third nerve, is intact. And therefore when I throw light on my left side, the left pupil constricts and my right pupil also constricts as a consensual light reflex because my efferent pathway, third nerve, is intact. So it constricts and slowly after some time it starts dilating. So then you shift the light from the left eye to the right eye. So now instead of constricting, it may be in the process of dilatation. Because of continuous exposure, instead of constriction, there will be dilatation of the pupil. So this is known as Marcus gun pupil, relative afferent pupillary defect, where the optic nerve of one eye is affected, but the optic nerve of the fellow eye is intact. So when you throw light continuously on continuous exposure, there is secondary dilatation instead of constriction. This is known as paradoxical dilatation of the light stimulated pupil. Paradoxical dilatation of the light stimulated pupil. This is about Marcus Gunn pupil or relative afferent pupillary defect. Now let's come to another fascinating concept, the anisochoria or meiosis or midriasis. So as I said in the beginning of my lecture, the normal size of the pupil is 2 to 6 millimeters. So when the pupillary size is less than 2 millimeters, you call it as small pupils or meiotic pupils. When the pupillary size is more than 6 millimeters, you call that as large pupils or midriatic pupils. So now let's see one by one what are the diseases and what are the pathophysiology of the meiotic pupil and what is the pathophysiology of the midriatic or large pupil. When we come to the meiotic pupil, the most important disease causing a small pupil what one needs to understand is Horner's syndrome. So Horner's syndrome, which causes ptosis, because Müller's muscles is affected, so it causes ptosis, it causes meiosis, and it can cause anhidrosis. The Horner syndrome is because of involvement of sympathetic pathway. You remember, I told that the constriction of the pupil is because of the parasympathetic pathway through the third nerve and dilatation of the pupil because of the sympathetic pathway. And therefore, when the sympathetic pathway gets affected, pupil gets constricted, and one of the diseases causing this is Horner's syndrome. So what is the pathway for sympathetic dilatation, sympathetic stimulation of the pupil, which causes dilatation of the pupil? It starts from the hypothalamus, descends, comes to the midbrain, pons, medulla oblongata, goes to the spinal cord, C81. From there it goes through the superior cervical ganglia, it goes to the internal carotid artery, cavernous sinus, and then it supplies the pupil. So if the sympathetic pathway anywhere in this area, in this tract, gets affected, the sympathetic pathway gets affected, and if sympathetic pathway gets affected, pupil cannot dilate, pupil will be small or meiotic pupil. Right. So the first order is from the hypothalamus to the spinal cord. It could be anywhere from the hypothalamus to the spinal cord. The classic syndrome which causes this is Wallenberg syndrome, the lateral medullary syndrome. The sympathetic pathway and spinothalamic tract pathway are on the sides, lateral. And therefore, when the sympathetic tract gets affected in the medulla oblongata on the lateral aspect, you get small pupil. Now, I am going to talk about a very interesting concept. It is just a speculation, but the mechanisms are not definitely known. The question is that sympathetic tract runs in midbrain, pons, and medulla oblongata. Then why only pontine hemorrhage produces pinpoint pupil? Why not midbrain? Why not medulla oblongata? Because sympathetic tract runs in all the three brainstem structures, namely midbrain, pons, and medulla oblongata. Why only pontine hemorrhage causes pinpoint pupil and not midbrain or medulla oblongata? The mechanism is not well known, but the speculation is that midbrain is supplied by two posterior cerebral arteries. Pons is supplied by a single basilar artery. Medulla oblongata is supplied by two vertebral arteries. That's why when the lateral vertebral artery gets affected, you get lateral medullary syndrome, Wallenberg syndrome, where the pupil can get affected. But not on both sides. Whereas if pons gets affected, you get pinpoint pupils bilaterally. Why? Because medulla oblongata is supplied by two arteries, two vertebral arteries. Midbrain is also supplied by two arteries, two posterior cerebral arteries. But pons is supplied by a single basilar artery. And therefore, if there were to be hemorrhage, a single basilar artery can easily burst and can cause hemorrhage in diffuse manner. The entire pons can get affected, and therefore the entire pons, both sides get affected. So both sides, the sympathetic pathway gets affected, and person will have pinpoint pupil. But when you take the midbrain, there are two posterior cerebral arteries. So it is unlikely for both the posterior cerebral arteries to get involved and cause a burst and can cause hemorrhage. And in medial oblongata also there are two vertebral arteries. So unlikely for the two vertebral arteries to burst and cause hemorrhage. Whereas in pons, it is a single basilar artery. It is a single artery. And therefore there are more chances for a single artery to burst and cause hemorrhage diffusely. And therefore it causes pinpoint pupil on both sides. Medial oblongata also causes, but only one side, lateral medullary. But here, since it is supplied by a single artery, it can burst and can spread in a diffuse manner on both sides of the pons, and there will be pinpoint pupil on both sides. A very important concept. You see pinpoint pupil, always suspect pontine hemorrhage or opioids also. Right. The second order is the, it comes to the spinal cord and then in the ciliospinal center, C8T1. Here, the disease could be syringomyelia. Here also there is an important clinical point. The C8T1 is the ciliospinal reflex center, and therefore if I pinch or irritate my nerve, it can stimulate the sympathetic pathway and can cause dilatation of the pupil. So if you want to check the intactness of sympathetic pathway in the neck, you can pinch it and see whether the C8T1 ciliospinal reflex center is stimulated and if there is dilatation of the pupil. Right. The third order is the sympathetic ganglia in the carotid arteries. So the third order is in the cervical ganglia, superior cervical ganglia, and then it can go to the carotid artery. So internal carotid artery dissection also can cause small tubular Horner's syndrome. Right. Now, how do we confirm whether there is Horner's syndrome or not? What we do, the sympathetic pathway is affected. Right. Sympathetic path is affected. So there is no dilatation of the pupil, there is constriction of the pupil. Is there really Horner's syndrome or not? How do we confirm? You can put cocaine. You can put cocaine and see whether the pupil is getting stimulated or dilates. If it is not going to dilate, that means it confirms Horner's syndrome. Cocaine blocks the reuptake of norepinephrine. So when there is no norepinephrine in the first place, how can it act? And therefore, when you put cocaine and there is no pupillary dilatation, it confirms Horner's syndrome. Right. Now, second, if the Horner's syndrome is involved, how do we know that the first order, second order or third order is involved? So, the second step is that we put hydroxyamphetamine. Hydroxyamphetamine releases norepinephrine. If first order or second order is involved, when you put hydroxyamphetamine, it releases norepinephrine and therefore the pupil will be dilated. But if it is a third order neuron, it is the final pathway, and therefore when the third order is affected, it cannot dilate. So if you put hydroxyamphetamine and if it dilates, that means it is a first order or a second order lesion. But the third order lesion, it will not dilate because the final pathway is affected. So these are all the important concepts for Horner's syndrome. As I said here, Argyll-Robertson pupil, accommodation reflex present and light reflex absent. So accommodation reflex present, light reflex absent, Argyll-Robertson pupil also causes a small pupil. Right. Another important concept is that the light causes parasympathetic stimulation and causes constriction of the pupil, whereas darkness stimulates the sympathetic and causes dilatation of the pupil. Right. When there is anisocoria, one pupil is small, the other pupil is large, you are not sure whether the larger pupil is because of sympathetic stimulation or the smaller pupil is because of parasympathetic stimulation. So how do we differentiate? Suppose if it is physiological anisocoria, normally or when you throw light or when in the darkness, the proportion will be the same. But when it comes to Horner's syndrome, when the sympathetic pathway is affected, when you throw light, when you put a person in darkness, the sympathetic pathway should get stimulated. But in Horner's syndrome, the sympathetic pathway is affected. Therefore, example, the right side, the pupil which is supposed to get dilated because of darkness, it does not dilate. Why? The sympathetic pathway is affected, Horner's syndrome. So it remains the same. But the other pupil will dilate because it is having normal sympathetic pathway, it dilates. So one side the pupil which is supposed to dilate, if it is not dilating, though there is darkness because of sympathetic lysis, and the other pupil normally dilates because of darkness and sympathetic stimulation. That means when the anisocoria is increasing in darkness, it is sympathetic lysis or Horner's syndrome. So anisocoria worsening in darkness is Horner's syndrome, right? Now let's check out on the large pupil, midiatric pupil, which is more than 6 millimeters. As I said, large pupil you get in Addis pupil. Here Addis pupil, ciliary ganglion get affected, accommodation reflex present and the light reflex being absent. One. Second, the third nerve, the parasympathetic fibers run in the third nerve, in the midbrain lesion. And therefore, any lesion can affect the third nerve. Example, after trauma, head injury, epidural hematoma or subdural hematoma can affect the third nerve, and therefore the parasympathetic fibers of the third nerve get affected. So parasympathetic causes constriction of the pupil. Since it cannot constrict the pupil on one side will be dilated, the other side will be normal. This is known as Hutchinson pupil, which you see in post-traumatic conditions where the trauma causes hematoma which goes and compresses the third nerve. The parasympathetic fibers on the third nerve gets affected. So the pupil is dilated on one side, the pupil is normal on the other side. You call that as Hutchinson pupil. Second is compressive lesions. Here there are two important concepts. The first concept is that the parasympathetic fibers run superficially on the third nerve. So any compressive lesion like hematoma or a posterior communicating artery aneurysm will compress the superficially placed third nerve. And therefore in posterior communicating artery aneurysm or hematoma, which is a compressive lesion, the first thing to get affected is the pupillary fibers. And therefore when the pupillary parasympathetic fibers get affected, pupils cannot constrict, pupil will be dilated. Whereas if it's an intrinsic pathology of the third nerve like dioptis, it affects the center of the nerve, sparing the superficially placed parasympathetic fibers, and therefore it will get all the other manifestations of the third nerve palsy except pupillary dilatation, because pupillary fibers which are placed superficially will escape. What are the manifestations of the third nerve? One, the dilatation of the pupil. 4 Ds, dilatation of the pupil, drooping of the eyelid, divergent squint and double vision. So in dioptic third nerve palsy, pupils are spared. So they'll have drooping of the eyelid, divergent squint and double vision, but pupils are spared. So very important concept, compressive lesions, the pupil are the first thing to get affected, whereas intrinsic lesions of the third nerve, pupils are spared, or if it is affected, is a very, very late manifestations. In fact, dioptic third nerve is sometimes known as pupillary sparing nerve. Another important concept is that the third nerve, as it comes out of the midbrain, very close to the third nerve are other arteries, superior cerebellar artery and anterior inferior cerebellar artery. Then only comes the posterior PCOM, posterior communicating artery. Then how come only the posterior communicating artery aneurysm causes third nerve palsy, when the other arteries are very close to the third nerve, like superior cerebellar artery and anterior inferior cerebellar artery, they should first compress the third nerve. But in practice, we see only PCOM aneurysm causing third nerve palsy, but not the superior cerebellar artery or anterior inferior cerebellar artery. Why? The reason being, the aneurysms are more common in the anterior circulation than the posterior circulation. Posterior communicating artery belongs to the anterior circulation, whereas superior cerebellar artery and anterior inferior cerebellar artery, they arise from the basilar artery, which is a posterior circulation. So posterior circulation strokes, posterior circulation aneurysms are less commonly found, whereas anterior circulation involvement aneurysms are more commonly found. Since posterior communicating artery arises from anterior circulation, the aneurysms are more commonly found in posterior communicating artery rather than superior cerebellar artery or anterior inferior cerebellar artery, though they are very close to the third nerve. So if third nerve is involved, it is usually because of PCOM aneurysm, not because of superior cerebellar artery or anterior inferior cerebellar artery. Very, very important concept. Aneurysms are more common in anterior circulation than posterior circulation, right? Okay. Then, as I said about the Horner syndrome, In Horner syndrome, anisocoria increases in worsens in darkness. Whereas when you throw light in third nerve lesions, when you throw light, the third nerve parasympathizes, the pupil should constrict, both pupils. But if there's a third nerve lesion, when you throw light in bright light, if suppose its right pupil gets affected, it will not constrict, but other pupil constricts. So if the anisocoria worsens in bright light, it is a third nerve palsy. But if anisocoria worsens in darkness, it is Horner syndrome. Anisocoria worsens in darkness, it was because of sympathetic lytic pathways. Anisocoria worsens in bright light, it is because of the parasympathetic being affected, the third nerve being affected, right? So this is about sympathetic and parasympathetic palsy. But is there any common lesion where both sympathetic and parasympathetic can get affected together? Yeah, it is possible. It is possible in cavernous sinus. In cavernous sinus, the sympathetic plexus run along the internal carotid artery, and we have the third nerve carrying the parasympathetic fibers also. And therefore, in cavernous sinus, both sympathetic and parasympathetic can get involved. And therefore, the size of the pupil will be in the midway, because both sympathetic and parasympathetic are involved. The pupil will neither dilate nor constrict, it will be in the mid position, right? Okay, now having told about so many concepts of pupillary disorders, how to approach and how we can simplify all these pupillary disorders? It is easily possible if we pose two questions. One, whether the light reflex is present or not. Second, whether the accommodation reflex is present. So now let's go step by step. First is whether the light reflex is present. If the light reflex is present and the anisocoria is more in the darkness than light, it is Horner syndrome. So the anisocoria is more in the darkness than in the light, it is the Horner syndrome. But if anisocoria is more in the light than in darkness, it is third nerve palsy. So first is light reflex, whether it is present or not. If the light reflex is present, whether the anisocoria is more in the darkness than light. If the anisocoria is more in the darkness than the light, it is the Horner syndrome. If anisocoria is more in the bright light than in the darkness, it is third nerve palsy. Now, if the light reflex is absent but accommodation reflex is present, what are the possibilities? The light reflex is absent but accommodation reflex is present. Then you have to check out on the pupillary size. If the pupil is small, it is Argyll-Robertson's pupil. If the pupil is large, it is Addy's pupil. So if light reflex is absent and accommodation reflex is present, you check out on the pupillary size. If the pupil size is small, it is Argyll-Robertson's pupil. If the pupil is large, it is Addy's pupil. So now I told about the concepts of pupillary disorders, but what are the take-home messages? One, about the light near dissociation. Light near dissociation, that means the light reflex gets affected but accommodation reflex is present. It is possible only in three places where the light reflex pathway and the accommodation reflex pathway are separate. They run separately. One, in the optic nerve, where the light reflex traverses through the optic nerve. But another school of thought is that accommodation reflex does not go in the optic nerve. It goes to the Edinger-Westphal nucleus directly. And therefore, in the optic nerve lesion, since only the light reflex travels, a lesion there only affects light reflex. So here in the optic nerve, light reflex is absent, but accommodation reflex is present because it does not go to the optic nerve. It goes to the Edinger-Westphal different pathway directly. So even in the presence of blindness, or even the presence of decreased vision, the accommodation reflex will be present in optic nerve disorders. The stimulus for accommodation is just blurring of image. So if there is a blurring of image, this accommodation reflex manifests. The second is in the pretectal nucleus, where the light reflex is absent but the accommodation reflex is present, because in pretectal nucleus only the light reflex pathway is there but not accommodation reflex pathway. And third, in the ciliary ganglion and posteriorly ganglionic structure, the nerve, because though the light reflex and accommodation reflex run together in this nerve, but after the lesion, either trauma or tumors, when there is a regeneration, there is a disproportionate regeneration of accommodation reflex as compared to the light reflex, and therefore light reflex is absent and accommodation reflex is present. So in these three pathways, optic nerve, the light reflex is absent, but accommodation reflex is present, because only light reflex travels through the optic nerve, whereas accommodation reflex enters the Edinger Westphal nucleus directly. Second is the pretectal nucleus, where only the light reflex is present, the light reflex pathway goes, so light reflex is absent and accommodation reflex is present. Third is the ciliary ganglion, where light reflex and accommodation reflex, though they run together, after the lesion, there's a preferential regeneration of the accommodation reflex as compared to the light reflex. So a light reflex is absent and accommodation reflex is present. First, the second take-home message is that anisochoria, which worsens in darkness, is Horner syndrome. Anisochoria, which worsens in bright light, is the third nerve palsy. And third, in the third nerve lesions, compressive lesions of the third nerve affect the parasympathetic fibers of the third nerve. So in compressive lesions, the pupils are the earliest to get affected, whereas in a diaptic third nerve palsy, ischemic lesions, the pupillary fibers run superficial and therefore they are spared. So in diaptic third nerve palsies, pupils are not involved. If at all they are involved, they are involved very, very late. So these are known as pupil sparing third nerve palsies. So this is in the nutshell an overview of pupillary disorders. I've enjoyed giving the lecture. I hope you have also enjoyed this lecture. If you have any doubts, suggestions or comments, you can post in my YouTube channel. If you have liked it, please like and subscribe my YouTube channel, Dr. Srinivas Medical Concepts, and my FB page, Dr. Srinivas Concepts. Thank you. Bye.